Developing nations discover America's secret plastic world. Yes, America's secret plastic world. They had to find the gimmicks of the Yankee trader, the flim-flam man, the snake oil medicine seller, whatever they call it. They got a collection of like about 20 or 30 really, you know, I say really cool, but they aren't cool, they're sort of insulting, you know. The epitome, which is often mispronounced as epitome, I finally found out, psych online. The epitome of this whole thing was the 5 and 10 cent store. I used to go in the 5 and dime back in the 60s. Get a big hamburger and a milkshake for 50 cents, you know. But, you know, like, you wouldn't really shop in the 5 and dime unless you really needed something that was going to hold out for just a little while, you know. It was like chintzy, you know. You'd never find a Cadillac parked in the 5 and dime parking lot. They usually didn't have a parking lot, just a couple of diagonal parking spaces on Main Street with meters in there, you know. And this is a big song about 5 and 10. I found $1 million baby in the 5 and 10 cent store. Yeah, well, you know, America learned how to capitalize on that, and eventually, you know, it came out further in the, you know, the front drop. You could make a back lot in Los Angeles look like Atlanta at the height, burning at the height of the Civil War, or Cleopatra's palace, for God's sake. It was just amazing. And I said, well, why not carry that through? I'll never forget, my mom took the nieces to Disney World once. It wasn't even Disneyland, it was too far away. And they said, well, what's behind this door? They opened this door, and they had inadvertently opened the door to the service entrance. And all they saw were these facades. They had stepped out from the gala street into, like, the back alley. There were forklifts running back and forth. It was like, that's it. America's secret plastic world of the plastic hippie turned yuppie. Yep. Yuppie. That's another word for yes. They didn't like hippie because that was Native American for human beings, so they got yuppie. Okay, developing nations discover secrets. They discover America's secret plastic world. Lincoln warned you. He said you can't fool all the people all the time, right? Eventually, somebody over in China is going to find out. Come on. Oh, you're not laughing? I don't know. I can't see it. It's like, I'm assuming there are a lot of straight faces out there. Good. Good, man. Wake up, buddy. Who the heck? It's nothing worse than a lot of people who have an inflated opinion of themselves, for crying out loud, bud. This is the bottom floor. It stinks down here, man. Listen, the Earth may have its problems, but it's got some spectacular views. Just get out there and enjoy the universe. Anyway, developing nations discover America's secret plastic world. You know, there's a problem with being flustest with the mostest. Eventually, the real players pass you. I'm saying, eventually, who, real players? Who are they? Who are the real players? Well, I'm going to tell you this, bud. You're going to find out. Because if you're asking that question, eventually the real players pass you. And you get, as the track and field term goes, lapped. America, the land of the flim-flam, the illusionist, the prestidigitator, and the Yankee peddler. That's what I was trying to think about. Well, your little plastic world had 'em fooled for the better part of a century. And now, it's their turn. For decades, you've been unwisely using the originators of gunpowder and producers of some of the world's greatest antiques. Ha! You've been using them for cheap labor. This, oh my God. It's like, what asses? Unbelievable. Oh, here we got this cheap labor over here. They only invented gunpowder. Maybe if you use them for the right thing, they would have come up with something better than gunpowder. They were using gunpowder to get rid of depression. When it was ignited in the sky at nighttime, it caused a massive stimulus in the retina of the observer. And they were beginning to find out fireworks helped relieve depression. Everybody who watched got the medicine. Huh? You know that. Every time you have fireworks, the crowd goes, oh. What do you think that is? Like, oh, that's cool? No, they're saying, wow. That's right. Antidote for depression, kid. Just get in a dark room, get those little Christmas lights, the smaller the better, and have them wink on and off in colors. And that will relieve seasonal depression disorder. You know, where, you know, like guys up in Finland, way up there during the time when in the north in the winter where, or the poles in the winter, their winter where the sun doesn't rise. Some people get so depressed they even are driven to suicide. That's the antidote. The Chinese were onto that about 3,000 years ago. Oh, what did you use gunpowder for? You put it in a tube and put a ball in one end and tried to use it to break down castles. Yeah, that's typical. That's type feudalistic mentality, huh? Come on, man. So, here we go. So, you grab hold of them during the time of their low point, and you just use them for cheap labor. You know, they could have come up with some Ming Dynasty type vases for you. Well, they caught on. In case you haven't been keeping up on your current events. But those guys have potential. When they go to space, they're the type that are going to be mining the asteroid belt while you're tripped off on your saga space movies. Oh, we got this five-year saga of going into space and living in the space station. Yeah. Oh, you got a big audience out there. You might as well make money off of them. They just want to pretend. They don't want to do it. That is the Yankee peddler, whoever you are, representative for every nation, being a Yankee peddler. Well, now, what's the better thing to be? What's the opposite of cheap, shallow? What is the opposite of the cheap, shallow, meaningless existence? Among other things, a bit of real civilization would be nice. It would be nice. A world in which whole forests remain intact instead of becoming peddler's mediocrity, stuffing your mailbox. A pet peeve? Maybe. Okay, let's look at something more pertinent. We now have a sort of throwaway society. That doesn't mean throw the society away, although that's what they're doing, but throwaway, hyphenated throwaway society. It's a throwaway society. This implies a temporary existence in which one camps out, as it were, to get something more substantial underway. Oh, wow, well, we got paper plates. We're just roughing it for a while. Oh, man. But it has become permanent in contemporary society, a sort of picnic lifestyle, generating garbage mountains. Picnic's okay if the neighbors down the block decide to go on one of these Saturdays. But now everybody does it every day, and next thing you know, you got a garbage mountain, man. And you get the garage badge. The point is, if you want to continue to live that way, don't expect to be a world-class power, because that's a lifestyle anyone can emulate, and eventually others will catch on and not only equal you, but and justifiably, I might add, not only equal you, but also best you. You will get bested. Forget the term owned. That's bull, man. Bested. That's the term you should use. Bested. Forget owned. Nobody want to own that garbage. They want to best it, man. Best it and get the heck out of there, right? All right. So, you know, the picnic lifestyle. They will justifiably, I might add, best you. I mean, you want, what? You want to be a world power with nothing more than a pathetic pop culture and a few trinkets? It's like, this is my best shirt, man. I never would wear something like this. I was thinking of doing something called the coffee shirt. That's a long sleeve t-shirt. But it would never look like this, man. Jeez. Oh, man. Yeah, some pathetic pop culture and a few trinkets. Big friggin' deal, buddy. There's only one place for a cheap shot like that. Oblivion. Oblivion. Yes, oblivion. You know, you're not even going to get time capsuled, man. They will just bury you. They will bury you. As Khrushchev warned, you don't even know. That's one of the problems today with United States society. They don't have Khrushchev anymore. They had to have some adversarial figure so that they would get prodded into productivity. You know, I was reminded somebody made a film called Wag the Dog. I never saw it, but the president is pleading with the Russians to start the Cold War over again so they can get back to business as usual. But they will bury you, as Khrushchev warned. How can I put it in other words? They'll simply forget you. They'll simply forget you. You will be recorded in history as an also-ran. Also-ran. A what not to be. Hyphenated word there. The kind of word the British cringe at. Great British writers, even contemporary ones, decent. Because, it's kind of like a short, using shortcuts and weak literature, but what do you want? What not to be? You know? I mean, I could be more eloquent about it, but then nobody would understand. What not to be, hyphenated. Wannabe is another one. The problem with this lifestyle of plastics and cheap housing made of pressboard, stuck together like a Hollywood prop, is that it's not unique. It's not unique. There is no real personality to it. No innovation, no greatness. Anyone in the world can imitate it. There's nothing to it, no substance. So I hear in the news, China is really close to the United States right now, out of nowhere to becoming the number one nation in the world. But then some Indian economist, they're also envious of China, because India is a democracy and China is this conglomerate thing. I went over this before, and this says, now wait a minute, based on this economics where you calculate things like cost of living, China is already number one. Yeah. And China is number two. Too bad, also ran.